Morning, NCF. It's so good to be worshiping Jesus with you this morning. Every Lord's Day gathering is an opportunity for us to celebrate the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And so even through this virtual means, it's a privilege that we can actually do that. Now, if you're here for the first time or just visiting us, a special welcome to you. We're so glad that you could join us. And we look forward to worshiping Jesus with you this morning. Before we proceed any further with the worship service, what we'll do is we'll take a couple of minutes just to pause, reflect, collect ourselves, put aside any distractions, literal or figurative, and let's just take a minute to orient our hearts and minds in worship. And the reflections that you see on page will help us guide us through over the next 2-3 minutes. So let's just take a couple of minutes to do that.
Yeah.
Once again, very good morning to everyone. And if you're just joining us, we're so glad you're here. Hope you're truly able to worship in spirit and in truth. In one of the great historical novels of the last few centuries, Les Miserables, Victor Hugo begins the story with a convict by the name of Jean Valjean. And his only crime is that he stole a loaf of bread to feed his widowed sister and her 7 children who are in poverty. Now, after 19 years in prison, he's finally released, but even his release is not freeing because he's on parole. And part of the parole requires him to keep checking in with the police and it restricts him with the duties he can do as a normal citizen. Now, as he leaves prison and he makes his way to town, he notices that no one's actually welcoming him, no one's willing to give him a job, no one's giving him shelter, simply because he's an ex-convict. He finally, after searching far and wide, he's finally welcomed by a priest. And the priest is kind enough to give him shelter, to give him food. But Valjean actually repays the priest by stealing all his silver in the night and runs away. Now the police eventually catch him, and they bring him to the priest and they ask the priest, is this the guy who stole all your silver? And in a surprising turn of events, the priest actually says, you know, he didn't actually steal it. I gave it to him. And in fact, you know what? He left a couple of pieces of silver back. And so just that moment of encounter with grace for Valjean, he encounters this change and he transforms. And the priest actually tells him, you know, out of darkness, God has pulled you out. And so Valjean, now having experienced grace, wants to go lead a good life. And the priest actually makes him keep a promise saying, you know, you will go and lead a good life. Now, the thing is, because he's under parole, he can't actually go and do the things that he wants to do. But he nevertheless just, he takes on a new identity. He breaks his parole, but he goes on to do good things for the society. He actually helps the poor. He helps the marginalized. He even fights for the oppressed. And he does all those good things because he's experienced grace. While that is going on the parallel, there's the antagonist, an inspector by the name Inspector Javert. And his sole purpose in life is to upkeep the law. And so he is ruthless in the way he executes his punishments for those who don't keep the law. And so when he finds out that Valjean actually broke his parole, he makes it his life mission to ruthlessly pursue this no matter what. He doesn't care that Valjean has experienced grace and compassion. All he cares is about justice and law. Now, while justice and law can be a good thing, in this case, 19 years in prison for just stealing a loaf of bread is so unjust. So the Inspector Valjean should have actually used his pursuit for justice and law to actually reform the laws. Now, for us as readers and listeners to this story, the most common approach is to pit one against the other. We look at the Inspector Javert and say, you know, that's law. And when we look at the priest and we look at Valjean and say, that's the gospel and that's grace. But there's another approach to the story. And that is when we look at the priest and Valjean, when they depict grace, they're actually keeping the law. So for example, when the priest actually forgives Valjean, he's actually following Christ's command to love his neighbor, to forgive those who have hurt him, to turn the other cheek. And for Valjean, who has experienced grace, he now goes on to help those who are oppressed. And so instead of pitting it as law versus grace, what we see here is grace fueling the priest and Valjean, whereas for the inspector, all that fueled him was self-righteousness and anger, even to the point where towards the end of the story, when he experiences grace and compassion, he takes his own life because he says there cannot be an ounce of grace in this world. You know, when we look at the story, it reminds us of a similar narrative, the Exodus narrative, where God delivers the Israelites and he gives them a set of laws. But the way he does it is not contractual. He doesn't say, follow all the laws and I will give you the grace and the gospel that is required. But instead, he gets into a covenant with his people and he truly delights in getting into a covenant because he says, I will be a God to you and your children. And so that is essentially our worship focus this morning, that here is a God who fuels us to love the law, to keep the law. But more than that, he delights in getting into a covenant with his people and he delights in keeping his promises. So with that in mind, let's now turn our attention to the call to worship from Psalm 19, verses 7 to 11. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous. Let's say this together. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the honeycomb. By them we are warned, in keeping them, there is great reward. Come, let us seek the Lord together.
Hi, good morning, Judge. Let's worship our great King, whose kingdom never ceases. There are no boundaries, there are no borders to this King. Let's worship. Mm-hmm. angels prostrate for, bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord. Bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among the peoples. For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. He is to be feared. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord glory due his name. Bring an offering, come into his courts. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness. Tremble, tremble before him, all the earth. Before the Lord, for he comes. For he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples in his faithfulness. Thank you. many crowns, the lamp upon the throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for me, and hail him as thy matchless king throughout eternity. Yet visible about in glory glorified. Oh, hail redeemed, hail, for thou hast died for me. Thy praise and glory shall not fail throughout eternity. Victorious in the strife for those he came to save. His glory is now we sing. Who died and rose on high, who died eternal life to me, and lives if death may die. Oh, one with the Father and Lord, one with the Spirit from yonder glorious throne. To thee be endless praise, for thou hast died. Be thou, O Lord, through endless days adored.
Amen. He lives, so death may die. Now we move on to a time of public confession of sin and shame. Just like Valjean in the story, who repaid the kind priest by stealing his silver, we too, like that, often having received grace and mercy, we repay by going back to our old ways, going back to our own sinful ways. And so we come and do this as often as we can, publicly confess our sin and shame. So follow along as I read. O God, you make covenants with your people and you keep them from generation to generation. We receive this grace from you, but we are slow to extend it to others. We find it much harder to keep our word. We offer promises we don't intend to keep, and we make deals that we intend to break. All too often, we are not trustworthy. Not to you, not to our neighbors, not even to those we love the most. We are sorry for the pain and disappointment that these sins cause. We need your Holy Spirit to strengthen our will. Forgive us, Lord Jesus, for all the ways we fall short of your desires for us, and hear us as we continue to pray. Amen. Now we have a chance to privately confess our sin and shame. So let's take a minute or two to truly introspect and confess our sins to our God who sees everything. If we confess our sins, God in Christ is faithful and just to forgive us of all unrighteousness. So hear now the assurance of pardon that Christ does forgive us. Therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the Gentiles seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Friends, in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. All of the promises are yes and amen in Christ. And all the people said, thanks be to God. Amen. Having now received this assurance of pardon and this grace that fuels us to live our life, we have opportunities to give thanks. And one way we do that is through our giving. And now we will give our offerings and his tithes. But if you are not a believer, if you're new to the church, feel no obligation to give. But for those who are members or regular attendees, we encourage you to give cheerfully. There are two ways for you to give. You can continue to give online, or if you prefer to collect your offerings and just give it when you meet in person, you can do that as well. Over to Sabio.
Ski. Before we do our announcements and prayer for the city, now it's time for the kids to go for their City Kids program. And the link is given in the NCF WhatsApp group and also in the City Kids WhatsApp group. So today, we have some announcements. First thing is that we are starting a new sermon series on the Ten Commandments, the Law of Love. And let's continue to join the online service and also continue to invite our friends for this series. And if you have been joining the NCF online or in person and you would like to go deeper in NCF distinctives and also would like to know what is our vision and also want to learn more about what it means to be a member of this church, please consider joining our NCF Explore class. That will be over 3 Saturdays. It will be on the 10th of April and 17th, and also on the 24th of April. And the timings will be from 3 p.m. to 5 p.m. And as we have talked about the upcoming congregational vote, so this will be held next Sunday, 25th of April, regarding the joining of the denomination Presbyterian Church in India Reform. So please kindly reach out to Rakshit or one of the elders directly if you have any questions or queries regarding the joining of this denomination. And regarding the in-person service, we will keep you posted about that when we will be able to meet again in person. And if you have been part of this church, like online and also in person, and would like to be a part of this community, we have fellowship groups. Which are meeting, some are meeting in person and some are meeting online, and you can consider joining one of the groups. It's in the bulletin. You will see that on there are different fellowship groups meeting. On Monday, there's Kotnur, one of the Kotnur groups are meeting online Monday at 6 p.m. And there is another group in Kotnur. We are meeting on Thursday at 6 p.m. Usually we meet in person, and there is a group in Indranagar meeting on Thursday at 7 p.m. and also Malleswaram Saturday at 3 p.m. So if you would like to be a part of the community, you could consider joining one of our fellowship groups and get to know people, and then we can be a part of your life and support you and pray for you. Yeah, these are the announcements that we have for today. Let's pray for the city. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Son Jesus, who has given us life and this freedom to come to you as your child and to come to you with our prayers and supplications. We praise you this morning, God, that you are a God of infinite sameness, that you remain the same God. Though our world, with the world that we live in, seems beyond and control and without hope, God, we are so thankful that we have you. We are so thankful for the comfort of your changelessness, because you are complete, perfect, and the circumstances that we have or we live in can't change who you are. And today, Father, we come before you praying for our city and for our nation, God, and also for the world, God, especially regarding the COVID situation, God. And we pray that, Father, you would help us to remind that, Father, despite all this craziness around us, God, you are still the same God. You are the God who was and is to come. And God, we pray, Father, especially for the vaccination that has already been there, God. I pray that people would be able to get the vaccination and that, Father, it will be effective, that it will work in our system, God, and we would be able to fight this virus, God. And we also pray for the doctors and healthcare workers and frontline workers that, Father, they will continue to be strengthened and that you would continue to give them the hope that they need to serve in this demanding time and be able to continue showing your love to these people who are suffering with this virus, God. And we also pray for those families who are affected by this virus, God, and who are suffering because of this, that, Father, you would strengthen them and then you would restore their health. And also, Father, today we remember our members, Father, who are affected by this virus. God, the Yalas, or Ben, Sonia, and Haley, and Uncle Eric and Auntie Ruby, and others, God, Father, that you would continue to give them the strength, Father, they need to fight this virus, and that, Father, you will restore their health. And God, I pray for your protection over, Father, our church as well, Father. We would be wise and in be able to, Father, get protected from this virus, God. And I pray that you will give us the strength and the hope and the wisdom, Father, as a community to be able to serve, Father, those who are suffering, Father. And God, I pray that you continue to remind us that, Father, you are there with us, Father, even when we can't see it. We ask all this in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is taken from Exodus 20, verses 1 to 17. And God spoke all these words, saying, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourselves a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water underneath the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquities of the fathers on the children to the third and the fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing steadfast love to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not take the name of the Lord your God in vain. For the Lord will not hold his guiltless to who takes his name in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter or your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his male servant or his female servant or his ox or his donkey or anything that is your neighbor's.
Good morning, friends. It's so good to gather online and worship Jesus together on Zoom. I'm so glad you're here. And I just want to make a couple of maybe just reminders or housekeeping items. We, the elders, are sort of closely monitoring the situation with the sudden rise in infections in the city. We're not sure what that exactly means for our in-person gatherings. We are in touch with FIBA to see whether it's doable or not and all of that, but we'll keep you posted on that, as well as the congregational vote on next week. depending on what we do next week, we'll keep you posted on how the vote will go about over the course of the week. We'll just keep you posted on WhatsApp. Last week we started with an overview of Exodus. And the reason I wanted to do that overview is sort of to place Exodus in the one big story of Scripture. The entire Scripture from Genesis to Revelation is one big story that even our present historic moments are captured by. And so I wanted to place Exodus where it fits in that big story. And also to help us, when we read Exodus on our own in our individual practices of Bible reading, wanted to sort of give some hermeneutical principles or principles to interpret or understand the book of Exodus rightly and how the book of Exodus points to Jesus Christ. And I want to make a couple of other principles to keep in mind, particularly as we approach the law of God. The first five books, the Pentateuch, Penta is five, the first five books contain various laws. And traditionally, the laws are divided into three different aspects. There are three divisions to God's law in the Old Testament. So you have the moral law, civil law, and ceremonial law. Okay, let me just work backwards. Ceremonial law is laws concerning ceremonies. Okay, ceremonial law. It is God stating how his people ought to worship him. So you have all the tabernacle, the specifications of the tabernacle, the specifications of the temple, the specifications of the kind of animals to eat and not eat, the kind of animals to use as sacrifices, what to do with those sacrificed animals, meat, what kind of clothes the priests ought to wear. All of those things are laws concerning the ceremony of worshiping God. When God's people are gathered, there are specific things God expects. And the principle is simply that we don't get to define how to worship God. We can't just go about doing what we want when we gather for service, gather for worship in person. God defines that. And so laws concerning ceremonies are simply a way for God to express how we ought to approach him in worship. And in the New Testament, it's all like sort of minimized. In the Old Testament, it's elaborate. In the New Testament, it's minimized to just a few things. We ought to gather in person. There ought to be an ordained gospel minister. The word of God is to be sung, preached, read, and seen in the sacraments of the baptism and Lord's Supper. And there's got to be good fellowship. Those are laws concerning ceremonies that are applicable today. And the second division of the law is called civil law, or laws concerning state. You see, in the Old Testament, God's people were a nation, right? God's people were an ethnicity and a nation, the nation of Israel. So God expected certain punishments and sanctions or rewards and blessings, whether or not people violated or kept God's law as a state governing the land. But in the New Testament, we know that there is not one particular nation that God calls his own, like the Old Testament Israel. People today, God's people today are all over the world. People from every tribe, tongue, and nation are represented as God's people. In the Old Testament, the kingdom of God was both spiritual and political. Today, the kingdom of God is only spiritual. But there will come a time when Jesus Christ will return and establish his physical reign on earth. We are looking forward to a political kingdom too, where Jesus himself will come down and reign as our king, and his laws will be enforced on all the earth. But until then, we wait as God's people. We are a spiritual kingdom, which is why Jesus Christ himself said, "My kingdom is not of this world." But there will be a time when Jesus Christ will return and establish his physical political reign on this earth in the new creation. But the third kind of law, third division of law, is called the moral law. It's the moral code that actually is the basis for both the ceremonial law and the civil law, laws concerning the state. So for example, let's take, you shall have no other gods before me. What does that mean for when we worship God? Well, those are laws concerning ceremonies of worship, that when we come together, we approach the true and living God, that it's an application when it comes to our gathered worship. What about the state? For example, you shall not murder. We just read that as one of the commandments. What happens when you do murder? There is a punishment established by the state, and God defines all of those things in the Old Testament. And in the New Testament, he's left it to each country to decide based on their own conscience and what's best for the country as a whole, to be rewards and punishments for those kind of crimes or kind of good behavior. Okay, so those are some principles to keep in mind. The moral code is the basis for both the civil law and the ceremonial law. And the closest thing we have in the New Testament until Jesus Christ comes back and establishes his political, physical reign on this earth is the Presbyterian Church government. Because Christ's kingdom is spiritual until he comes back, the place where Christ's reign is exercised fully is in the local church. And Jesus Christ runs his church through the church government that he has established for his people. Okay, that's the first thing. There's a threefold division to God's law in the Old Testament: moral, civil, and ceremonial. But the second principle is that the moral law is eternal. It is not something that God gave first to Moses. It is actually what God wrote on the human heart. Adam and Eve were created with their laws not written on stone, like he gave to Moses, but written on the human heart itself. But because of sin, over time, our sinful nature seeks to erase that law written on our hearts. So, which is why, depending on where you go in this world, you will see some degree of the moral law practiced by people in different parts of the world. Some laws more than others are honored. And in some places, it's even enacted in the law of the land. It's the constitution has it even. So the moral code was originally written on the human heart. But over time, particularly by the time that the Israelites were subjugated by a foreign culture with foreign practices, over time, the sinful nature seeks to erase God's law written on our hearts. And God writes it on stone tablets for the very first time. In fact, it's the only portion of scripture that does not have a human author. Have you thought of that? It's the only portion of scripture that does not have a human author. God himself comes down and etches the Ten Commandments into stone tablets. There's only one author, and that's the divine author. And Moses simply hands it down. But of course, the way we receive it today is not, we don't have access to the stone tablets. It's written in scripture for us, and God uses human authors for that. So those are the two principles to keep in mind when you're reading the Old Testament. The Old Testament law has three divisions: moral, civil, and ceremonial. And the moral law is eternal. It was written on Adam and Eve's heart, and it needed, because of sin, to be written down for us in black and white ink, which is why we have it in scripture. And it's binding on all humanity. This moral code is binding on all humanity. So before we go any further, let's pray. Our Father, we thank you so much for speaking to us. And would you please open our eyes to see Christ, open our ears to hear truth, so that we might enjoy eternal life. In Jesus' name, amen. We have a natural aversion to law, don't you think? I mean, for example, even if we were to take, even if we were to consider ourselves as well-behaved citizens of India, every time there's a traffic signal and we are on the front, there is this temptation to sort of jump the signal. And or perhaps you're one of those people who never thinks of, even if you're on the front line waiting for green, you never think of sort of like jumping the signal. But perhaps even you are tempted to think of, man, if you had the green signal, you could save so much more time. You could accomplish other things. Or perhaps the temptation is even more felt when there is no one at the other signal where there's green. Why is there green? There's no one in that light. I wish I had the signal, or I wish we had the signal, so we can get on with our lives because we have places to be. We have a natural aversion to the law. And our mind, I think, quickly starts to deviate from that which we are told to do into things that we are told not to do. And I think that applies to God's law too. There is a t-shirt that I've been wanting to get for some time now. I saw it somewhere and I was like, that's a great, great t-shirt. It says gravity. It's not just a good idea, it's the law. And I think that applies to God's law too. We can say the Ten Commandments. It's not just a good idea, it's the law. We can't escape gravity, can we? Even if you have to fight gravity, you have to experience gravity in order to fight it. Even if you disbelieve it, you still are experiencing gravity. You can't escape it. Similarly, God's law, you can't escape it. It's just there. Even if you choose to disbelieve it, even if you choose to deny it, even if you didn't know that such a theory exists like gravity, you can't escape it. Similarly, God's law, one cannot escape it. And what does God do in the Ten Commandments? I mean, God reveals that he alone is God. And what is this character of this God? And that's the first thing we'll see, God's character and ours revealed. God's character and ours revealed. It's a famous, you know, scene in the movie of a war movie, particularly if it's set in the medieval age. You know, troops are aligned on the other side and your kingdom is lining up troops to fight against the opposing army. So you set your archers on top of the fort, right? And then you can imagine the archers pull and are ready to shoot. And on command, they aim high and shoot. And the opposing troops are not expecting it. They're expecting arrows to fly straight at them. But instead, out of nowhere, they see arrows flying over them and arriving and landing on them. It's something similar that we see in today's passage. God had promised Abraham some 600 to 800 years ago, before the Exodus event, that there will be a time when Abraham's descendants will be enslaved. In Genesis 15, we read, "Then the Lord said to Abraham, 'Know for certain that your offspring will be sojourners in a land that is not theirs and will be servants there. And they will be afflicted for 400 years. But I will bring judgment on the nation that they serve. And afterward, they shall come out with great possessions.'" So 600 to 800 years after God promises Abraham that his descendants will be enslaved, but he will deliver them. He delivers on the promise. It is not an arrow of promise that's going straight into deliverance, but it's an arrow of promise of deliverance that goes over the waiting period of enslavement of 400 years, that goes over Abraham actually being of the father of a multitude of people. It goes over all of that history and lands at the appointed time of deliverance. God delights to keep his promises. He always keeps his promises, even if it feels like a long, long wait of 600 to 800 years. God will always keep his promises. So what's the first thing that God does after he leads his people out of the land of Egypt? They're at Mount Sinai, and God has descended upon the mountain. And for the very first time and the only time in human history, God himself comes down and writes the Ten Commandments with his finger. But what does he do first before he gives the Ten Commandments? He gives what's called the prologue or the preface to the Ten Commandments. He teaches us how to relate to the Ten Commandments. He teaches us how to reveal to God's law. And the first thing he says is, I am Yahweh. I am the Lord. The word there, the Lord, is actually Yahweh in Hebrew. And what does that mean? Yahweh means I am that I am. Remember Moses. He's told by God at the burning bush, go and tell Pharaoh to let my people go. And Moses asks, like, who should I say is this God? What is his name? They may ask. The Israelites may ask, he says. And God out of the burning bush says, tell him I am Yahweh. I am Yahweh. I am that I am. And it's an interesting name, isn't it? I am that I am. But think about it. No one can actually claim that name. Because we are all human beings, we say. But truth be told, we always change. We never are the same thing at any given point of time, are we? Ever since I started preaching to you, I have grown 15 minutes older. I have changed. I have changed in so many ways that I don't even know in the last 15 minutes. You have changed. We say we are human beings, but really we are human becomings, if you will. There's only one being who remains a being all the time. As Jojo put it in her prayer, God is the God of infinite sameness. He's the God of infinite sameness. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I am that I am. He's reminding the first thing that God tells his people out of Mount Sinai and writes by his own finger is identify who he is. I am that I am, God says. The same God who promised Abraham 600 to 800 years ago to be the deliverer of his people, 600 to 800 years later, comes down and delivers his people. Doesn't that evoke a sense of confidence? As we prayed in our public confession of sin and shame, even the promises that we make, we don't intend to keep. Even our own flawed sense of morality, we often flout them. How much more so God's nature, right? But God says, I am that I am. I'm standard. I am the same. You can trust me. God reveals his character first before he gives his people the Ten Commandments. He says, I am Yahweh. I have an unchanging character. I possess self-existent power, glory, and holiness. I am the only incontestable being in all of the universe to claim to be Yahweh. I am that I am. I never change an ounce. And so, this God, the only unchanging God, demands that his creatures obey him wholeheartedly. And then the second thing that stands out is that this God speaks. I mean, that is significant because the Israelites have been enslaved in a land where the gods never spoke. The gods only took. They never gave. They never spoke. But this God, this unchanging God, by the way, of all the other gods of Egypt who always changed, and it was even Pharaoh was regarded as a god, but Pharaohs changed. They came and when they died, they were never the same. Their laws were never the same. Against all of that background, God says, I never change. I am your true king. And then he speaks to his people. God spoke these words. Do you see that? And isn't that so comforting to God's people, that God speaks to us? He's not a dead and silent God. He's not a God, if he's a true God, who leaves his creatures to grope about in the universe to try and find out and figure out about him. No, no, no. He has spoken. He has revealed himself. He has shown himself who he is to us, his people. God speaks. He is not silent. He has revealed his character. So now we have somewhat of an understanding of who this God is. This God is Yahweh, the Lord. I am that I am, the unchanging God. And this unchanging God speaks. So against such a character, God calls his people to compare themselves to him. He says, you are always changing. You are always sinning against my character. The Ten Commandments are actually an expression of God's own character. It is not something that he wrote down that is independent of its of himself. The Ten Commandments are actually the blueprint of God's own character. It is character of God written down for us. And as God's image bearers, we were called to image that character of God. But we sinned. And that's the second thing we will see. We are condemned by God's law. In the when the Israelites were still in Egypt and they saw the 10 plagues come upon Egypt, the frogs and the locusts and the Nile turning into blood, water turning into blood, and the killing of the firstborn and all of that. They saw what the true and living God can do to all the false gods on earth. Through dramatic intervention, the Israelites were told, if you behave like an Egyptian, this is what will come down on you. And isn't that true of all of our hearts, my dear friends? When we look at the Ten Commandments, an expression of God's own character, and we know that we were called to image that character, reflect that character, and we see how woefully we fall short of God's character and his requirement of his creatures who are image bearers. We know we are condemned. You shall have no other gods before me. We worship false gods every day. We worship money. We worship lust. We worship power every day. Even now, perhaps your mind is wandering about into other gods that you can worship. God's character condemns our character. God's law condemns us. We need deliverance. We need someone who will pluck us out of the Egypt of sin. The 10 plagues were a show of God's majesty and kingship, that there is no God in all the universe like this God, because he is the creator of all of humanity. And all of humanity, when they look at this holy God who is the creator of heaven and earth, they see and find themselves to be utterly morally bankrupt. They are sinners condemned by God himself. Thirdly, then, we are saved by God's law. Isn't it remarkable that the 10 words, the 10 commandments, follow the 10 plagues? The 10 commandments are supposed to be read in with the backdrop of the 10 plagues. It is a sign, it is a way of God to say, those who do not keep the 10 commandments perfectly, the 10 plagues will fall on them too. Who is there to save us then? Because we fall short of all of the 10 commandments all the time. Who will save us? Who will deliver us? Who will rescue us from the Egypt of sin? Is there anyone in all of humanity who will come down and rescue us? And as we sang in Christ alone, God himself took on flesh in the form of helpless babe, Jesus Christ. He became one of us. He represented humanity in the place of Adam, who failed us. He has become the new representative. He obeyed God's law perfectly. He kept God's law perfectly to the T. He not only obeyed God's law perfectly, he took on our suffering and our penalty for our lack of law keeping. For all the ways in which we failed, he took it upon himself to pay the price. And he took it upon himself to pay the price after he kept the law perfectly. What love is this, my friends? We are saved by perfect law keeping, but not by our perfect law keeping, but by Christ's perfect law keeping. There's only one human being in all the world, in all of human history, to have obeyed God's law perfectly. There's only one human being who reflected God's character perfectly, and that's Jesus Christ. He alone, my dear friends, is the Redeemer of God's elect. He's the only Redeemer of God's people. We are saved by Jesus Christ's perfect law keeping. This Yahweh, he says in Leviticus 26, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, that you should not be their slaves. I have broken the bars of your yoke and made you walk upright. Again in Hosea, I am the Lord your God who brought you out from the land of Egypt. You know no God but me, and besides me there is no Savior. This is God's word to you, my dear friends, if you have trusted in Jesus Christ. There is no Savior but this God. There is no Savior but Jesus Christ. He is the one who has brought us out from the Egypt of sin into the new creation of freedom and liberty. There is only one person who is capable of doing that, and that's Jesus Christ. So what do? Having escaped the Egypt of sin into the promised land. And that's the fourth thing we'll see. Our gratitude program in God's law. The preface, the prologue to the Ten Commandments say this. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt. Out of the house of bondage. Therefore, obey me. Do you see that pattern? Each one of those Ten Commandments are God compels us to receive those commandments only in reference to God as their Redeemer. Only in reference to God as their Redeemer. Out of gratitude, God says, follow me, reflect me, obey me. It is God's law, the Ten Commandments, are a gratitude program for God's people. Because God has brought us out of the land of Egypt, the Egypt of sin and slavery. God says, come and now obey me. True freedom, my dear friends, is a fruit of the redemption that Jesus Christ has purchased for his people. This freedom can nowhere be enjoyed apart from obeying God's commandments with gratitude for Jesus Christ. Because Christ has broken the chains of sin from around our souls, he demands that we now love him and keep his commandments. He demands it of his people because you and I were bought with a very costly price. Let me conclude with a few words. When it comes to obedience to God in the Ten Commandments, there are two dangers to keep in mind. Two dangers. The first danger is what theologians call antinomianism, or against law keeping. It's this notion that because I'm saved, I'm free to do whatever I want. Because I'm saved, I don't have to keep God's law. My dear friends, that's a danger. It's detrimental to anyone who holds such an opinion of God's law. God cannot be trifled with. Because God's law is a reflection of his own character, it makes no sense for God's people to say, I have been saved by a holy God. Now I can act in an unholy way if I should so choose. That Christ has purchased me, now I can behave the way I want. It makes no sense, my dear friends. Because what we should want if we believe in Jesus Christ is to keep his commandments. Isn't that what John 14:15 says? Jesus Christ said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. So if there's any one of you who struggles with this danger of antinomianism, that if because God has saved me, I can behave the way I want, ask yourself this question, what do you want? Do you want to honor the one who lived and died for you? Do you claim to believe in Jesus as your savior and yet deny him as your Lord, who gets to demand the way you ought to live? My dear friends, if you're an antinomian, if you're someone who has fallen into the danger of saying, I can live the way I want because I'm the Father's child, be careful. Because the Father's child always loves Jesus Christ. Not perfectly, but in a growing way. But there is a love for Jesus Christ. And if there's any degree of love for Jesus Christ, it ought to be followed by a commitment to keeping his commandments. If you love me, Jesus said, you will keep my commandments. But there's another danger. On the other extreme is legalism. It's basically to take away the preface that we just read. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. I am your redeemer. To actually erase that line and then to read the Ten Commandments on its own. It's to use the Ten Commandments not as a gratitude program, but as a merit program. To use each one of those commandments as a way to earn God's favor. That if I did not murder, then God is accepted and pleased with me. Then I am accepted and God is pleased with me. That if I don't lust after other women or men, then I am accepted by God and God is pleased with me. No. My dear friends, the Ten Commandments rightly understood, and we will get into them one by one starting next Sunday. The Ten Commandments rightly understood, none of us truly matches to any one of those commandments, not even one. And elsewhere in scripture, we learn that if we break one of the commandments, we break all of them. If we violate God's character in one of these aspects, we violate all of his character, not just one aspect of him. God demands perfect obedience. And to those who struggle with legalism, to use the Ten Commandments as a merit program, you need a savior. I struggle with legalism occasionally and in different ways, and I'm constantly discovering ways that I'm a legalist. My dear friends, we fail the Ten Commandments. We violate God's character. We need a savior. Jesus Christ is our savior. Since Jesus Christ is our savior, the law of God is no longer a merit program. Adam, for him, it was a merit program and he failed. But having been rescued from sin, the same law has been given back to us by Jesus Christ, out of the hands of Christ to his people, to be a gratitude program. So watch out, my dear friends, as you reflect and learn about the Ten Commandments, starting next week, one by one, attach the preface that God is our Redeemer. We have been accepted by God for the righteousness of Christ if we repent and trust in Jesus Christ. We are accepted. Now let us obey. Let us obey because God has bought his people with the life of Jesus Christ. Let's live that with gratitude. So the next time you are tempted to the danger of antinomianism against law-keeping, or legalism, on the other hand, manipulative law-keeping, know and remember that you are not your own. You have been bought with the price of Christ's life. Because we are Christ's, we are called to keep his commandments because Christ has already won the Father's favor for us. In fact, that is the way to understand each of the following Ten Commandments. God wants us to remember that we have been saved from the Egypt of sin, and we are being led by Jesus's own hand into the new creation of blessing and joy. So Jesus says, if you love me, keep these Ten Commandments and enjoy life. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you, Father, for these Ten Commandments. Thank you for revealing your character to us. Thank you for showing us that our character falls woefully short of your character. Thank you so much that Jesus Christ has obeyed your law perfectly. He has fully reflected your character. And we thank you for giving us the hope that one day we will be made like him over time, being sanctified, being made to look more like Jesus, so that as we look more like Jesus, we look more like you, Father. So would you please make these Ten Commandments not a burden, but a blessing? Would you please teach us to obey you, not out of a sense of drudgery, but out of a sense of joy and delight, because Jesus is ours and we are his. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Raksha. Let's sing of our great Redeemer. Set me free. Sing, oh sing of my Redeemer with his love. He purchased me on the cross. He sealed my pardon, paid the debt.
Well, it looks like we lost the musicians there due to internet connectivity. So I think we will skip our last song and receive the Lord's benediction. Remember that we will I will keep us posted with regards to our next services on the WhatsApp group. It'll also be made as an announcement on our website as well. And so I'll keep us posted on that as well as our congregational vote next week. Again, please feel free to reach out to me if you have any questions about our joining a new denomination. Receive now the Lord's benediction. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. May the peace of the Lord be always with you. And God's people respond, thanks be to God. Amen. Friends, thank you for joining us. Hope you all have a great week.